So linked together is mystery, fallibility, and possibility. The reason I think that mystery, fallibility, and possibility go together, we have, I think, by and large, pretty disconnected people in neighborhoods in the United States. They don't have a lot of connections. They're not contributing to the lives of each other, not very much. And I think the primary reason for that is they've given their lives over to the mystery solvers, right? To the people who run big systems, maybe under some overarching idea of science. You know, science is about eliminating mystery. Nonetheless, they have all kinds of possibilities there, and their possibilities can look limited because everybody knows everybody has some fallibilities. And a service society is constantly announcing, you got problems, you need professional help, right? So people are trying to buy their way out of a fallible world or assign to the big system people finding a way out of the fallible world. And both those are strong cultural phenomena that erode the culture of the possibility of our creating a rich, satisfying set of relationships here. So people who are, I think, thinking in an asset-based way are people who are, say, fallibilities. People all have them, they all have needs, but what I can see is their gifts and their capacities. And possibility only exists if I can see that. So I've got to be saying, I live with fallibility. You have to accept it then to see what's there, right? And not say somebody out there is going to do away with that person's fallibilities.
Let me ask you a question. So using the metaphor of Sherlock Holmes, and maybe let's throw in Dr. Watson,
yeah,
okay?
Right.
Because Sherlock essentially masquerades as being able to solve the mystery, solve the unsolvable. Mm-hmm. And then Dr. Watson comes in to provide the service to an extent. So, you know, when I guess that incursion happens, the message is, first of all, utopian. We can fix you. Mm-hmm. You are fixable. This problem is fixable. Yeah. We can take your pain and suffering away.
Yeah.
Death can be conquered.
Yeah.
Right? Limitations can be overcome. And I suppose if we look at that in a sense, you could say that what they might be saying is on your own with your community, you are insufficient.
Yes.
Onto each other.
Yeah.
You're inadequate, therefore, you know.
Collective fallibilities.
Yeah, yes, exactly. And I just want to explore this, two ideas actually. One is around sufficiency. So we are sufficient unto each other, mm-hmm. and we can live a sufficient life. And that's that actually the entry point to satisfaction, to a mm-hmm. satisfied life, to a sensational life, mm-hmm. is actually sufficiency, a very old concept, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I, when I hear you use the word productivity,
mm-hmm.
I hear it in that sense,
mm-hmm.
that a productive life is when we see each other as sufficient unto each other and ourselves as well, and we live sufficient lives. That's how we can walk light on the planet, consume. So that brings all of the domains together in a sense. And that's what you mean by a productive life. It seems to me that an awful lot of people who hear this, who have become enculturated into the utopian ideal, mm-hmm. When they hear the word productivity, or indeed the word asset, I think they hear it through a consumerist filter. Mm-hmm. And I think when they hear you say productive, what I think they hear you saying is, you know, get a job, or, you know, get up, pull yourself up by your bootstraps, or, you know, be productive in the classic neoliberal sense. Mm-hmm. And I know you don't mean that. Yeah. So could you say a word or two about sufficiency and productivity?
Every time I say productive, I feel a hesitancy about the word. Because of what you're saying, I really do. And what I'd love to do is for you to find a better word. Because productivity, I think, comes out of the industrial mindset, right? And I'm thinking is on a power ladder, the most powerful people who are productive. What I mean is, they have within their own hands the ability to decide what is to be done, how it will be done, and that they will do it. Now, the word for that process I've used inadequately, I believe, productive, right? And I don't have a better word right now, but I know there is a better one, and I'm counting on you to come up with it. Because I've thought a fair about can I think of something better than this, but you're right. And I'm sure if Ilitch were here, he'd in a second give us another word. So I would say, as near as I can think of a word, would be satisfied, being able to use your assets in the ways that I described. We're doing it, we know what they are, and we're deciding what we want to do and how we want to do it, and we do it. But if you do that, what you'll come out with is something more satisfying than if you buy it or invest in it. And it raises the basic question, do you really believe that people can be satisfied in a world of limits? And the answer to that, I think, in everybody's life is clear. In the utopian word of no limits, it keeps people constantly dissatisfied by its nature, right? It's saying, you bought this computer, and it's a wonderful, superb computer, but 3 years ago from now, you want to throw it away because you're in a culture of dissatisfaction.
Yeah. Obsolescence.
Right. And that's because We are moving ever more, removing the mysteries, solving the problem. But the very process of being in that culture leads you to be dissatisfied. There's nothing more dissatisfying than the consumer culture. And it's all predicated. We get the morning newspaper and there are a bunch of advertisements in it for stuff, right? What that's trying to say to me, you don't have enough, right? And here's a bunch of stuff that you never thought about, but now that you don't have it, you'll be dissatisfied, right?
Let's just think about this from another angle, okay? So we often say a gift is not a gift until it's given. Right. I think it's also fair to say it's not a gift until it's received. Mm-hmm. So this whole point around exchange is really significant, it seems to me. Now, if we look at a satisfying life outside of consumer culture and some of the markers of that, we were talking the other day about Aboriginal culture, and the marker, you know, the breadcrumbs that we can still trace are things like songlines.
Yeah.
Now, to an extent, you could say that they were co-created generation after generation and steward it as well, you know. So there was a lot of repetition, maybe some innovation, but the core was always, you know, honored and passed on, passed down, and was received, you know. And we know what happens when it isn't received. You know, it just becomes something we read about rather than something that community practices. So let me just talk about that idea of producing and receiving, giving and receiving, contributing and receiving. Because what I notice is a lot of the most productive people in community have a real big issue with recognizing the fallible parts of themselves that need to receive.
Yeah, right.
And this is an interesting kind of ambivalence I notice a lot, you know.
Yeah.
That the folk that are contributing most are often the folk that struggle most to receive the contributions of others.
Yeah.
And the fifth asset is the asset of exchange.
Uh-huh.
Now, hiding, you know, turning down the dial on productivity.
Yeah.
And turning up the dial a little on receptivity and exchange sounds like an interesting point of inquiry. You know?
Yeah, yeah.
And it seems much more open to mystery, much more open to, it's not an interpersonal thing. Mm-hmm. It's not all just contingent on me and how I relate to you and how we become connected. But there's something bigger than just even the human and the economic and the cultural and the environmental. And I'm not trying to point you in the direction of a spirit world or, you know, your view on God or whatever. But I guess what I'm curious about is there a sense that this whole idea of creating a culture of exchange, which honors the environment, honors culture, and in some way it keeps the economy embedded in society, right? Is that just about humans getting better at being human together? Or do you think, 85 years on this planet, do you think that there's some stuff that we might call mystery that's beyond just human interaction and its connection to environment and culture?
Which people would call... say something about the spirit.
The spirit level. Yeah.
Well, I happen to think that there is a spiritual dimension to being human. I'm not willing to argue with people who don't. So I'm not an advocate in that sense. And there is the idea of a spirit, but then there is the idea of spiritual, right? And I don't know whether people separate those two things or not. When I think of something that's spiritual, I think it is having been involved in something that manifests the essence of goodness. And that when you do that, there's a joint feeling, I think, that I would call spiritual. That something here is more, now that we have been engaged around these values and in the way we're related to each other, which is two ways, reciprocal, and some very significant thing happens. That I think at that point there's something, there's a dimension there that I would call spiritual. When I see in local places people who are telling you with pride about something they've done and you can see them light up as they tell you, I think that's what I'm seeing is a spiritual dimension to what they're telling me about.
Yeah, that
makes don't know if there are spirits.
No. But it's almost, it strikes me that there's a resonance between what you've just said and Martin Buber's idea of I, we, thou. So there's a sacredness to that community connection, which is is bigger than the interpersonal, and more of more consequence.
Yeah.
And therefore, it isn't just something that people co-produce.
Yes.
It's something that is of another dimension, or needs more expansiveness to be described.
I like the word sacred. It has a little more meaning to me than spiritual.
Spiritual, yeah.
Every person in this neighborhood is sacred, says to me, of value.
Yes.
And you could say of value to each other, right?
Yeah.
And of value, if you believe in God, because they were created by God, they must be sacred. So I think people who feel everybody is sacred are likely to be people who are gift-oriented, who are not looking at fallibilities and saying, that's in these people, and therefore we're going to cast them aside.
And just a final thought on this. So the word sacred and the word sacrifice have become broken apart, but actually there was once a time when they were together and sacrifice didn't have a negative connotation.
Mm-hmm.
So yesterday we were talking about the mother who was carrying not just her child, but the child of the village.
Yeah.
And the birthing process might have been seen as sacred, and the act of it as a sacrifice, as a gift to the community.
Yeah.
And just again, did she produce the child? You know, yes, she did. But also, there are many other things kind of happening. So
a word's come to be to substitute for produce.
Great.
And it's make.
Yeah.
A maker.
A maker. Wonderful.
Because produce does sound industrial.
Yes.
Modern industrial. But maker is something I made it, you do with your hands.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And so handmade, homemade.
Yeah, homemaker.
Are what comes out of the ultimate state, which is we're making a home.
Yeah.
We're making a home. Yeah. This we're making this village, right? That's what satisfying, right? It's we did it. I see so many people who show me something they bought with pride. They got some new handheld device that tells them whether it's going to snow next year, right? Or any other thing. But they're showing it to me with great pride.
Yeah.
Well, why? They didn't make it. Right.
Yeah.
It's
now, the power of the word, John, and I absolutely, it resonates strongly.
Yeah.
The power of the word is, if I come to your home and Marcia or you make something for me and I don't receive it, I think you could charge me with quite legitimately being ingracious or being a poor guest.
Yes.
And so I think the virtue of the maker is that it answers that question about the receiving as well as... So it really is in the domain of exchange and reciprocity.
See, and you could also say community maker.
Yeah.
It might even be better
than builder. Absolutely.
I don't know. I just a little footnote, because it's always amused me. If you go to watch the Chicago Cubs baseball players, and the field is full, everybody has pride in them, right? They pay good money to go there and watch them, and they cheer, and they feel so good. And they wear a Chicago Cubs shirt, and they're feeling really good about themselves because of what nine people, none of whom are from Chicago, half of whom are from the Dominican Republic, right? And they're taking credit for it. You know, I mean, the pride in something I have bought as against something I have made, it's just incomparable. But the pride, look at my new car. I mean, the consumer society has misplaced pride.
That's right.
It's put it in buying rather than making.
Making, yeah.
And so that's what we're talking about here. And I believe that it's important for people to feel self-worth. They do all kinds of unsatisfactory things if they don't, I think. And self-worth, I think, doesn't ultimately come from buying something. It comes from making something, right?
That's right.
And what has happened in the consumer society is that most people are almost totally useless in terms of their ability to make something.
Yeah. And so as we conclude, yeah, maybe one of the things that we can conclude with, and hopefully this will become a composite of our conversation, yeah, and a podcast. So perhaps just as a final thought to the listener, it strikes me that one of the things that people who are listening and ourselves, mm-hmm, are being invited to is to make afresh some new decisions,
mm-hmm,
mm-hmm, together, mm-hmm, with our neighbors.
Yeah.
Another act of making,
yeah,
of really beginning to think about how do we make together,
yeah,
a culture where everybody can be a maker.
That's right.
Both, yeah, receiving and contributing in, yeah, exchange with each, yeah, other. John, it's been a real pleasure. Have you any closing comment that you'd like to offer?
Just to follow up on what you're saying, to say, we made this. Our community, we were the makers of it. That's another way of saying what you're seeing is our way.
Yes, that's right.
We made it. We didn't buy it.
That's right.
We didn't borrow it, yeah, right? We didn't steal it. We made it.
We made it.
Right. And it's satisfying in it, therefore, because we made it, it's satisfying in a way that the consumer buy,
yeah,
will never be satisfying. And it's satisfying, but it is also lifting up my sense of worthiness. That I, together with somebody else, can make something. The opposite of that is impotence.
Yeah.
I'm impotent. I can't, yeah, do anything. Yeah. And the reason I'm saying this at the end is this sense of self-worth is especially important when we think about people who've been shoved to the bottom.
Mm.
And the first step up I know from organizing is, I am somebody. And how do you know you're somebody? Because together with others, you made something, and you have our way. And people who still have a vivid culture, I notice, have great hospitality, and they offer you an opportunity to come in to join our way. I think you'll like it.
Yeah, beautiful. You've just triggered something, and I just need to put it out there. One of the things that strikes me about We Made It, mm-hmm, is that the handmade and the homemade, mm-hmm, is necessarily imperfect. It is,
yes,
a combination of the fallible,
yeah,
and the gifts.
Yeah.
And just a last, so Leonard Cohen passed away,
yes,
a couple of weeks ago, and he had a great expression for this. Everything has a crack. That's how the light gets
in.
That's
it. Yes, yeah.
Maybe
I've quoted that myself.
So beautiful.
So it, yeah, says, It's from fallibility that possibility arises.
That's right. So what a perfect way to end. Yeah, right. Thank you, John.
Good.